Among all the triumphs, all the tragedies, all the miracles, and all the disasters throughout the world, only a few captivate the attention, hopes, and prayers of an entire nation and the entire world. July 24, 2002 marked the beginning of an incredible four-day journey of nine miners at the Quecreek Mine in Somerset, Pennsylvania. Quecreek Mine, owned by the Black Wolf Company, was mined 24 hours a day, split into 3 8-hour shifts. Each shift had two groups of nine men. They were tight groups that knew each other well. They entered the mine at 3:30 p.m. on a battery-powered car for a half-hour ride. Their day started as any other. John Hunger, Ron Heilman, Thomas Foyt, and Randy Fogel would all run roof bolters to secure the roof of the mine, while Dennis Hall and Robert Pugh made the coal shuttles. Mark Pompernick ran the continuous mining machine that freed up massive amounts of coal with its rotating steel teeth. Their section of the mine had seven entry tunnels laid out in a grid. Pompernick was drilling southeast towards the old, retired Saxman Mine No. 2. That abandoned mine was 300 feet away, according to the maps used by the miners. At 9 p.m., the miners were getting ready to finish up their shift at 11. It was just 2 hours before they could go home when Pompernick's steel teeth chipped away at the wall between them and 150 million gallons of water held in the Saxman Mine. Water started gushing in through the wall. Immediately, the crew knew they were in trouble. Somerset County has a rich tradition in mining. Western Pennsylvania in general has had a huge part in the production of coal. Affecting the area economically, socially, and politically, the mines were a crucial part of everyone's lives, whether they worked in the industry or not. Fortunately, Quecreek Mine has never had a casualty. The worst incident was a small piece of the roof collapsing where no one was hurt. The United States has made great strides to protect one of the world's most natural resources and those who harvest it. Safety in mines has increased in the past century. While once hailed as one of the most dangerous professions, coal mining is now a much safer job. Technology and safety have reduced the accidents such as cave-ins, fires, and above all, explosions. One of the most dreadful days in mining history was December 6, 1907, in the town of Fairmont, West Virginia. A fully ethnically diverse fleet of men entered the Monongah Mine No. 6 and No. 8. The day began and work was underway. At 10:20 a.m., a massive underground explosion shook the entire mine. Dozens of men were killed instantly. The underground tunnels connecting the mines were mangled and obstructed, while the entrance of both mines were blocked off. The explosion ruined the ventilation system, which brought on a massive wave of bad air filled with poisonous gas. The fumes delayed the rescue because rescuers didn't have protection for themselves. Some rescuers were rushed to get medical care for the inhalation of bad air. Fires erupted, producing harmful smoke. Whoever didn't die from the collapse or fire was killed by the poisonous fumes. The official report claimed that everyone was dead, but one man, Peter Urban, escaped. Mr. Urban's twin brother, Stanley, was one of the 362 men and boys killed. 250 women were widowed, and over 1,000 children were left without fathers. Ironically, Peter Urban was killed in a coal mine by a cave-in 19 years later. After a devastating year in 1907, where over 3,000 miners lost their lives, Theodore Roosevelt recognized the increasingly dangerous profession that coal mining was becoming. In order to protect resources and human life, Teddy Roosevelt proposed that the United States Bureau of Mines be established. The public didn't react wholeheartedly to the idea until the death toll rose after a rapid succession of disasters took place. May 16, 1910 was the day Congress passed the Organic Act, which created the U.S. Bureau of Mines. Joseph A. Holmes led the organization and was the author of the saying, "Safety First." The organization helped, but they had little enforcement. In 1941, the Coal Mine Inspection Act allowed them to freely inspect mines and recommend changes. It wasn't until 1969 when the Federal Coal Mine Health and Safety Act was passed, giving the Bureau real enforcement, developing standards of safety. The act was in response to the explosion, killing 78 people in Farmington, West Virginia, at the Consolidation Coals No. 9 mine. The Bureau of Mines may not have been created if it wasn't for the hard lessons learned from the previous disasters. The 20th century is full of mine disasters, especially in the early decades through the 1960s. Since then, there has been continual progress in mining safety, equipment, and disaster planning. The strides in mine safety have come from government and private efforts to make mining an honorable and less dangerous profession. Water was gushing through the entry Tunnel 6, blocking Pompernick in Tunnel 7 from the other 8 men. He tells the 8 men to leave, and they reluctantly do so. Thomas Foy yells for the men to get out. Dennis Hall got to the emergency phone to send out word of disaster to the other group of 9. They attempted to escape along the conveyor belt in Tunnel number 4. They had to reach a dip in the mine before the water did. After traveling 2,000 feet along the conveyor belt, they had to turn around.
While they were trying to escape, they were in water literally up to their eyes for most of that time, and they began working their way back up the belt line. But now they're going uphill and against the current. But when they were coming down, the water was at their backs pushing them, and they were going downhill, so it was a rather easy descent.
Upon returning, the 8 remaining miners found Pompernick trapped in Tunnel number 7. With Randy Fogle's quick thinking, he drove a coal scoop over to the rushing water and used the scoop as a bridge for Pompernick to climb into. He was then pulled into Tunnel number 5 with the others. They decided that they were to build walls from cement blocks to slow the water's progress. The Arnold family found their family dairy farm full of rescue workers. Soon they became an important part of the rescue process. On the surface, using GPS technology and a manual survey, they located the exact position to drill a 6-inch air hole.
Those two surveys came together within 6 inches of each other. When you're doing surveys from two different areas, accuracy on the first shot is around 31 feet, meaning these two sites should have come 31 feet close. They came 6 inches.
While drilling was underway, massive pumps were installed to get as much water out as possible. As the miners built their walls, they heard the drilling and knew help was coming. The drill bit broke through at 5:15 in the morning. They tapped the bit to let the rescue workers know they were alive. The tapping was heard 240 feet above ground, giving the families hope. They could not finish building the walls as the water became too overpowering. The men moved to higher ground in Tunnel number 1. They thought their time was up. They reflected on their lives and prayed. They recited the Lord's Prayer and asked God to help them from the situation. They all missed their families. They found cardboard, ripped it up. They took turns writing notes to their families. The water had to be stopped. John Urosik, a ventilation expert, proposed a solution. He said they could create a bubble in the mine. He wanted air compressed into the area of the trapped miners and the hole to be shut. This idea was never tested in the United States. No one knew what to expect, but it was all the rescuers had. The plan worked, and the water stopped. The drilling for the rescue tunnel began on Thursday at 6 p.m. The miners who were starting to feel the effects of hypothermia heard the drill and boosted in hope. As this was going on, millions of gallons of water was being pumped out of the mine. 8 hours later, at 2 a.m. on Friday, the drilling noise stopped. The drill bit broke. It was at 114 feet, nearly halfway there. A new drill and bit started 75 feet away from the first hole at 11 a.m. The first bit was later removed. Drilling in the first hole finally continued at 8 p.m. The drill bit broke through at 10:15 p.m. A communications line was dropped through the 6-inch air hole, and then everyone knew all 9 were alive. Randy Fogle was the first to be brought up at 12:50 on Sunday, July 28th. 15 minutes later, Blaine Mayhew was the second to come home. After him, every 15 minutes, there was Thomas Foy, John Unger, John Filippi, Ron Heilman, Dennis Hall, Robert Pugh, and lastly, Mark Palmer.
Primarily what happened over the months and the years after Quecreek was that the mining industry became more aware of the deficiencies that they had in keeping control of their mining maps. What I'll never forget about it was the fact that a miracle occurred, and everybody has seen the fact that that miracle occurred.
You know, it's amazing that bit broke and held us up as long as it did, and I said, you know, how is that a good thing? And if they would have continued drilling at that rate, when they broke in that air compartment and released all that air pressure, and I said the guys would have drowned, and he said no, they wouldn't have. They would have been embedded into the coal. Everything worked exactly the way it was supposed to work.
At times, in the past century, coal mining has been a tragic story, disasters one after another. Had one thing gone differently in this rescue attempt, Quecreek would be another chapter in that tragic story. This rescue defied the historical pattern set before it. This was no typical tragedy, it was a triumph. History may have suggested a disaster, but human determination and divine intervention led to a miracle.